Okay. You can see my screen, right? Okay. So this payment gateway is like okay. Hello, you can hear me, right?
Yes, yes, sure.
So payment gateway is a service where we can like enable third party either banking applications or any other third party vendors who can provide the payments for us. So like in our application, currently we are using Axis Bank, CC Avenue, and we integrated Paytm and PhonePe, but these two are not currently used in any other states. Like, we did this one like to see whether it supports or not. Okay. So second, okay, I'll first explain the flow, how it works, then we can go into the like actual payment gateway service. Okay, so whenever the citizen clicks on the pay button in our application, so there will be a consumer code, like in our case, like for a property, so property ID will be the consumer code. If we are using trade license application, then trade license ID will be the consumer code here. Okay, so you like whenever user clicks on the pay button, UI will call backend service like to the payment gateway service. Exactly. Okay, so what this payment gateway service will do is like it will create a transaction ID, unique ID. So, and forms a URL based on the requirements, requirements according to the third party vendor. For example, Axis Bank requires merchant ID, like who is like calling the particular application, and what is the amount we have to pay. And like in our case, we want, let's say we are doing it for Uttarakhand. So for Uttarakhand, there are like eight municipalities currently participating in our application. So if a citizen is paying for Haldwani, like ULB, then money should be deposited into Haldwani's account. So for that purpose, we are sending the account number as well in the URL. Okay. So this PG service will create a transaction unique ID. And like what is the amount it should be paid and what is the account number of the ULB. Like there will be some other parameters as well, but these are the main: merchant ID, account number, amount to be paid, and consumer code. So four. So these four will be added to the URL, and it is sent to the UI. So now UI will be redirecting the user to this particular URL which we sent to the UI. Okay, then once the citizen completed the transaction in third party payment gateway, so it will send what is the result of the transaction to the UI. Okay, using a get method, HTTP get. So what UI does is like it extracts the details from the written URL from third party, and it will call the PG service again with the transaction ID and consumer code also will be sent, but mainly transaction ID is the main key parameter here. So based on the transaction parameter, we will PG service will validates the status of the transaction with the third party payment gateway, and if it is successful, then it will update the collection service saying that this payment has been collected. If it is like failed, then the transaction will be marked as failed and user can retry again. Okay, so this is one happy flow. But if the transaction got cancelled in this particular transaction ID, okay, then so it is like canceled and it is not returned to the UI, to our UI, then it is in pending status. So we have a reconciliation job which will run for every 15 minutes and it will check for the pending status, transactions with the pending status, and it will call this status to check the transaction, okay, and if it is failed or success, then it will mark it as success or failed. Otherwise, like it will mark it as a it will mark it as a fail if it doesn't get any status from the transaction, okay. And even if one thing, like if it is not getting the status, then it will keep it as a pending, and it will every day in the morning we will do the transaction again, like we will check it for this reconciliation job will check for the status with pending in the morning, okay, and if it is failed, then it will mark it as a fail, okay. So this is one scenario where third party payment gateway will be sending response in a get method, okay. So if like this third party like payment gateway is not like is sending it as a post, like post method, then UI can't handle it, like UI cannot handle the get method, sorry, post method. So so we designed this payment gateway keeping that it will send it as a post method. So like recently we got one more like payment gateway which is not using this get method as a response. So in that case, what we have done is like we added another endpoint in transaction service, like a payment gateway service. So what it does is it simply, whenever it gets a post call, it will read the parameters which is sent from the third party URL, and in that parameter we will be sending the original UI URL as well. So whenever we get the response from third party the payment gateway, so we will redirect them to the original UI. So and the flow will be same like as previously. So payment gateway, we will call the UI now. So and UI will call the PG service with the transaction ID, and the flow will be same. Okay, so this is one particular flow. So if you have any doubts, like we can.
Can you explain the second flow again? Means how the post.
Okay.
The call
is. Yeah. Yeah. So what we will be sending in this case, UI will be UI will be calling the payment gateway service. Okay, in this URL, what we have to do is like we will send the redirect URL also to the payment gateway.
Okay.
So that URL contains like what is the original transaction ID, what is the consumer code, and all these details will be there in that URL. Okay. So once the user in the sense citizen completes the payment, then this payment gateway will call that redirect URL to us.
Okay.
So in that redirect URL, we are saving this UI URL also. So from endpoint, so this is a redirect endpoint. So we will consume that post method, and we will redirect the user to this particular URL which we are getting from UI. Okay. I think it will be better. It will be clear when I show this.
In this case, in this case, it's like we payment gateway is only providing us back if case of success, what to redirect. In case of failure, what to redirect.
For every call in this, like we will be redirecting the user to third party payment gateway, right?
Right.
While sending this URL, we will be using account number, merchant ID, amount, and return URL as well.
Okay.
So this return URL they'll use to return to our particular application. So if you understood, right, which return URL we are sending here. Okay. So this return URL will be UIs if that is supporting get method.
Okay.
So this here, the return URL will be like payment gateway endpoint. So that it will call the payment gateway endpoint, like backend service with the post call. So then we will redirect them to UI. You understand?
Yeah, I just wanted to clear one thing. In the case of React, why we are first taking it to UI and then we are making the PG call to save in database, the transition. In case of post, we are doing the flow like, okay, first persistent database, then go back to the UI.
I'm coming to that point only. So this one was like later we have to do it for Uttarakhand. So we didn't have much time to do it. So that is why this flow is only in Uttarakhand as of now. We did not even merge it to the product. Okay. So if you want to do it, like we can directly skip this step. Okay. This third part we can skip and directly we can third part and this one also we can skip. These three steps we can skip. And whenever UI redirects the citizen to there, then they can directly get that third party payment gateway directly can call the PG service. Okay. And if PG service is like successful or failure, then we can redirect the user to our UI directly.
Okay.
Saving the URL. Okay, this one is like why we did this particular thing is like, so we don't want to change the UI much, like because we have to change the UI as well if we don't want to use this particular thing, right? So that is the reason we went for the backend change instead of doing both the change, like changing both of the services, because anyway we are changing the backend service. That is the reason we did this one. Okay, so you can if you don't want this step, like then you can directly go like remove all these steps, and once after getting the response from the third party, you can directly redirect it from PG service to UI to the particular screen where you can show the citizen whether the transaction is successful or failure.
Shiva, just one time to clear my understanding, I'm just telling you, in case of GET, you are making the call from UI to PG service, which is our eGov service, then to payment gateway, then response will come to the PG service, again eGov service, then to UI, right, in GET call?
In GET call, it will be like this, okay?
Right.
So UI to PG service, okay, then to payment gateway. UI. No, then to UI. UI will be redirecting him to third party. I'll say third party. Okay, then they'll call UI. Okay, so again from UI it will call PG service.
Okay.
Again the PG service will call third party. Okay, to get the like status of the application. Status. Okay. And once it gets the status, and it'll send a like JSON as a response to the UI. Okay. So this based on the JSON response, like UI will show whether it is failed or success. Okay, this is one flow. Okay, if it is like GET, then the case will be a little bit different. So till here, it will be same. Okay.
So previously you explained for the POST part.
Yeah, this one is for GET. Okay. So this one is for POST. Okay. So. Okay. After third party, what it does is it will call the PG service. Okay, PG service in turn redirects to UI. So in this part, like there will be PG service, like it'll be then this flow will be same. Okay, you understand? Like, I think, is it clear or shall I tell one?
Just one minute. UI to P in post call, UI to PG service to get the token means kind of unique ID for the
Yeah.
transaction. Then again, we came to UI, we called a third party. Then the
Redirect.
third party, okay, redirect to third party. Redirect that third party give the post return URL as a PG service. In
Yeah.
PG service, we made the entry of the success or failure here only, right?
No, here we don't do that. We just simply redirect here.
Okay.
We simply redirect to UI. And UI again calls the PG service.
Okay.
Then
Then
it
we are
means
updating the status of transaction into our service. Okay.
here we'll check the status of the transaction, which like about the using the transaction ID, we will check it. Like this one will be a post call, not the redirection. Okay, like REST call, we are using the REST call here. We'll use the REST call to check the transaction of like transaction status.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and based on that, we will update the collection as well and send it to the UI. Okay.
Okay.
So this step is like we can skip this step. This one and this one, like both of them can be skipped. But like since we don't want to change the UI, that's why we added this one. This one does nothing. Like whenever it gets the like a request from third party, it'll extract one parameter and it'll forward it to the UI. Okay, using a 302, like in HTTP, if you are familiar with it. Like redirection service will be there, right? So that one will do, simply redirecting to the UI. So, like if you are clear with them, this is the main thing. That's why I started with this one. Yeah.
It's like just wanted to ask this means why we are first like after the payment we are first taking to UI and then we are updating the status. Why we are not directly doing it like after the payment response should be at PG service and the PG service acknowledge and then the final response come to the UI.
Yeah, I get what you're saying here. So you want to skip these two steps, sorry,
Right.
skip this one and directly go to PG service, and PG service will be updating the UI,
Right.
right? So this is the case, like like we want to check it the third party status. Like we want to like it is a recommended like recommended step to be taken by the payment gateways, that we have to check the status
Right.
again. So that is why, like that is one reason. And so since like we are using only REST calls in front end app, okay, so we don't want to use this like 302 service, because if the third party directly calls this UI, sorry, calls the payment gateway service, then we have to redirect the user to UI again. So when we redirect to the UI, it'll load all the services again, like
Right. Okay.
application again in React.
Right.
So that is the reason we don't want to do it initially.
Okay.
Yeah. So and this one again came. So I now whatever you say is a like best thing to do. I think in the next version or maybe whenever the time, like there is a roadmap for it. So whenever they change it, then you'll get it. You'll get this change in the next version, maybe. Yeah. So this is a flow. If you are understood, then we can go to the like I think we'll go with one example so that like you'll get more idea of it.
Okay.
So I have it here. So this one, like these are the endpoints here for payment gateway service. So create is to generate the URL and transaction ID. Okay. So in this call, what we do is like whenever we get the consumer code. So with the consumer code, we'll call the billing service again and to verify the pending balance. Okay. So we want to match it and then only we want to send. So that is one validation, business validation. We are doing it here. Okay. And transaction ID will be generated. And return URL also will be there. That is sent from the UI, that return URL with a request to the create call. Okay. So this redirect call is what we are saying, like what I was telling you guys. So it will simply receive the response from from third party, and it will redirect it to UI. That's it. So this update call is where we will be updating the transaction, like updating the status against the unique transaction ID. Okay. So this is search is like just to show whether the transactions, like show all the transactions based on the transaction ID or consumer code. Okay. And one more is like, in this create call, business validation is there, like if there is any pending transaction with the same consumer code, we will not allow the payment again. So that is one more business validation here. I think it is obvious. So this reconciliation was like I told, right? So for every 15 minutes, like this job will run. So we can configure this like this timing. Okay. So reconciliation will be created. Transaction that were created 15-30 minutes ago, which are in pending state. Okay. So, and it will run one more daily in the morning. So two times it will run for each pending task. And this is the like project structure. So in config, I think it's better if I show this.
This two reconciliation is there. One is 15 to 30 minutes. It will be like, why at two loop level we are having, because anyway it's running after every 30 minutes to 15 minutes. So
Early cancellation is like if we didn't receive any response from the redirection response from the third party, then it will be in pending status.
Okay
So it will we want to check this one initially for only this one. So like this pending task, particular transaction ID pending task will be there, right? So okay. We only check for that particular transaction, not all the things.
Okay. Yeah. And in second case, what thing extra we check it?
To a reconciliation transaction that created 15-30 minutes ago. I think these are like both of them are same, like for particular thing. Like let's say if it is like 15
means 30 minute batch, whatever comes, you put it in, okay, whether it's in pending state or not.
Yeah. So last 15 to 30 minutes, like I think we can configure these two.
Okay.
This was like written a while back. So I think these will check only jobs which are like 15 to 30 minutes back in pending status. Okay. So this daily job will do for all the transactions which are in pending status. All of them, not 30 minutes ago, I think.
Yeah, if it's getting covered in 30 minutes, obviously it should get covered in one day also.
No, if the status is still pending, then we will that will be in pending status only, right? So right. That will be in daily reconciliation job. That will goes to daily reconciliation. If it is done within 15-30 minutes, then that will be marked as success or failure. Okay, if the status is still pending, then it will covered in this daily reconciliation job.
Okay, so you mean to say that if the one-time payment is failed against that transaction ID, you are allowing the user to do payment or what?
Okay, so yeah, one second. So if in the initial transaction, first time, okay,
right.
So this is in pending status. Okay, we did not receive the response from the third party saying right. That it is in status. Okay, so there will be one job in like in 15 minutes, like it every 15 minutes there is job which will run the statuses which are done in 30 minutes, like last 30 minutes it will fetch the transactions which are in it will fetch the transactions which are in pending status, and the time created time is less than 30 minutes,
right?
Okay, so and if the status is like successful, failure, it will mark it success and failure accordingly. If it is still pending, then it will mark as pending only.
Okay, reconciliation is killing the pending process, right?
I'd not get you.
Means reconciliation so, means like, we are canceling the job plan, which are in pending state, right?
Yeah, we are not canceling them. We are again checking for the status of the transaction.
Okay.
Like, let's say some of the banks like have like pending status for 7 days.
Oh.
Okay. So they doesn't know whether funds are transferred or like it returned back. Okay. So if it is transferred, then it will be success. If it is failed, like it is returned back, then transaction is failed. Okay. So that is the case where this one will cover if it is like not covered in 30 minutes. Okay. If it is still pending.
Okay.
You understood, right?
Yeah, got it.
Some of the transactions, they are like pending for 7 days. That is the reason we have this other daily reconciliation job.
So 7 days, so we won't be entertaining only.
Like if it is in pending status, for 7 days, they can't retry the payment.
Uh-huh. Okay.
If it is in pending status, they can't retry. So that is the reason. Like we will do it for 30 minutes. If it is failure, then they can try it again.
One thing is like when you're saying this means what is the meaning of reconciliation? Means you are canceling the thread or you are reverting it back or what means?
I think we are just checking the status of the transaction, right?
Yeah.
Reconciliation means.
Yeah, checking the status of the transaction.
So from the third party.
Yes. So I'll tell you. From third party, they'll like we are redirecting them to the third party URL, right? So they provide one more URL endpoint so that we can check the transaction status.
Right.
Okay. So we will check the transaction status which are in pending with a unique ID.
Okay.
So if it is still pending, then we will leave it as is. If it is failed or successful, then we will update it. Okay. Reconciliation means like we will check the status. That's it.
Okay, so we will be checking with indefinite time until it doesn't get some status, either success or failure, right? Either every day we will be checking, now this payment status is success or failure. Until unless we doesn't get any one of this option, we will be checking it. We won't be killing it at any point of time.
Usually these transactions will be failed by the third party URL if it is like crossing their status, like most of the banks will have 7 days, some of them has like 2 days or 3 days business days. Okay, so after three business days they'll update it to fail.
Okay
so that is how it is.
So basically there are two jobs running, right? Two jobs running. One of the job does the checking of last 30 minutes transaction, and another job is for
which are in
pending state for a day. If it is more than 30 minutes, then the second job will take care of that, right?
Yeah. If it is more than 30 minutes, then second job will take care of it, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, and this, I can show you this payment gateway service, okay. So you have access for this repository, right?
Right.
Okay. So I think this is pretty much like generic Spring Boot application. So where like configurations will go to in config file and service services will go to this service page. Okay, so if you want to implement your particular payment gateway service, like for particular Access Bank or ICICI Bank, then you have to implement this gateway interface. So this got a few methods in it. So generate a redirect URI. So generate redirect URI is where this is a method which will get the request from UI with all the details. I'll show transaction as well. So it returns is like URI which can be redirected to redirected from UI. Sorry, from UI. This methods job is to construct the URL in the format provided by third party payment gateway. Okay. This method is reconciliation job will be using this method to fetch the status of the transaction. Okay. So after citizen completing the third party payment, so that they'll give a response to us. So what we have to do is we will be checking this transaction result again. So that checking is the job of this method. Okay. And this is normal method, this is for for UI or to enable, I think I can show one of the implementation to you. Okay. Okay, this is for So this will return the gateway name. So which is Access Bank or Access. It should be somewhere here. Yeah, Access. So whenever you are getting the request in transaction, so one second. Okay, so this is transaction. So we are getting all these details from the UI, tenant ID, which ULB we are paying, amount, transaction amount, billing ID, and this is module is for property tax or trade license, so that any other modules if we have. Okay. Consumer code is unique ID of the particular against which we are making the payment. So if it is I told you, right, again, consumer code is where property ID or trade license ID. So this is taxes and payments. I think with the bill ID, it is associated with the bill ID. For which period and for which period we are paying this one. That is the details which we have in this one transaction. And again, yeah, this is the gateway which we are using. So we have to send it as a part of request. So which payment gateway we want to use. If there are couple of them, then you can mention it Access or CC Avenue, so that. So this is a callback URL which we are I told you, right, to which URL it needs to redirect once the payment is success. Okay. This redirection URL is which we are sending after constructing, which we are sending, right, that one will be in this redirection URL. So this will be populated in response. In request it will be empty. Okay. And what are the other things required? Yeah, even this one is like also populated by the PG service. So this is the transaction ID which we are sending. Okay, and most of them are like similar things. So if you have any other like any other details which you want to save it in the transaction, so you can add them as a JSON in this additional details. So this will be saved as a JSON in the Postgres database. Okay, I think that's with this one. Yeah, so these are the pending status, like failure, success, and pending, like transaction status. Okay, and
else, which is this file you are referring?
Like request. This is the request which we get to the transaction, like a payment gateway create endpoint. Okay. Even update endpoint also will receive the same transaction. Okay. And this bank account ID is not.
But we are not going to change anything here, right?
No, you're not changing. Like, yeah, if you
we should be only aware of the contract that service consumes, right?
Yeah. What? Yeah. And if you want to add some other, like which is not there here, okay. If you have, suppose like there can be a number of items you want to save it in database, like we can't add everything, right? So in that case, we have one particular additional details. So you can send a JSON object in this one, okay? So whichever you send it in additional details, it will be saved as a JSON in the database.
Okay.
So you can use these details if required. Like okay. We want to add some more details from the in the transaction like table, then you can use this additional details. So for example, I can say like this additional details will be in every contract. Okay. So okay. For example, in property tax, if so one state doesn't have Vasaikar number, so it is used in Punjab. So that is one of the main thing to be saved for the property. Okay, but that is not there for other property like details in the other state. So what we do is like we will save the Vasaikar number in the additional details. Okay, and if you want to like validate this data before coming to database, then you can use the Joule service. Like I think you got KT of that, right? Like before hitting this create endpoint, we can configure another service. Okay, so what it does is like whenever you get a call to create endpoint, it will Joule will interfere in it in the middle, okay, and redirects the same request to the to this particular service which is you wrote, custom service. And in that custom service, you can validate this additional details. And if validation is successful, then you can send a 200. Then what it does is it will continue with the same call, create transaction. If it is failed, then it you can directly send 400 or a bad request to the user. You understood, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that has been covered, right, already, the to interfere the calls in Joule. I think in Joule service they have told you this one. Okay, so this is one thing. So if you want to change, then one thing is like you have to implement your own payment your own gateway service, okay, which I showed on this one. This interface you have to implement this. Okay. And I think I'll show you what are already implemented. And so you have access to this GitHub repository, or you have to use like, I think it is open for everyone.
Core service are open. Core service and front end and business service.
I think. Okay, so in services gateway, we have these four as of now: Access and Paytm, PayU and PhonePe. So these three are like not used currently, so we did not test them properly. So Access is currently running in Punjab, so you can trust it and properly tested. Okay, and what else? I think yeah, I'll show you this. Application dot properties. Okay, these are like anyway, these are common for like logging and path, which port to use and all these things. So this is for data. This is Flyway, Kafka, and persister configs. Yeah. You know persister, right? Anyway, I think it has been covered already. So this is IDs and where we like, this is the format which we can use. Like, we can change this format as well to generate the particular transaction ID format. So this means like it calls the sequence, database sequence, and it will get the running number from there. Okay, and this adds the today's date, and this is the current financial year. Okay, there is format for in ID gen. If you can check it, like you can add the ULB name, like some different combinations you can try. Okay, this is for billing service, calling billing service and collection services. So this one is like I'm not sure if you need a banking bank account details, then you can use this service. Otherwise, you can skip this. Okay. And okay, coming to the third party configurations. So this is to say that whether this like if you don't want to use any particular payment gateway, then you can mark this as a active as a false, so that like if anyone try to post using this particular Access Bank, then it will throw an error saying that this is not active. Okay, these are the values which we send to the third party while forming the URI. So currency, what is the currency and in which language the user have to see the UI in their Access Bank site. So this is merchant ID and secret key which they will be providing for us. These four will be providing from the Access Bank. Okay, I think this one as well, these four. These five things will be provided by them, so that we have to give all these details in every. Okay, and yeah, I think these are all the extra parameters which we need to send, and these two are the success. I think no, actually this URL is to check the status of the transaction. Okay, after like. What is the status of the current transaction? Is it failed and what is the amount in it? So we will be validating that status and transaction amount as well. Okay, and this is the redirection URL. So we will be redirecting it to this particular URL with all the other parameters which we'll send. Okay, and there can be like we have to like sometimes some payment gateways require to like encrypt every like total URL and send it to them directly, like so that will be different from each payment gateway. Okay, that can be taken care in the redirection URL format. Like in that method you can do everything whatever they require. Okay, and these three are like not used now, so I'm leaving it for now. Okay, and one more thing I want to tell you is like, so is there any requirement for you guys to deposit in multiple accounts?
Right now, that we are not sure, but we have a requirement to payment gateway. Our payment gateway will be NIC actually. NIC will be having its own payment gateway to the payment that will be doing it.
Okay. I think then you can use that one.
Access one, right?
So I think
modifying the access one.
This is the configuration which. No, you can add your own.
Yeah, I can add it as a reference. We can use the Access Bank one.
Yeah. A reference, you can use Access Bank, yes.
Okay.
So in reference also, you just need to change the particular, like anyway, these things like generate a redirection URL, and that can be done. Like you can use this, but there will be some changes like in hashing and encryption.
Okay.
And this is the status, so it will get shown, right? Like 1 second. So this method will use this URL, status URL. This one, okay. So in redirection, we will use this one. Okay. And if this is working, why I'm not sure, like why it is not working. So there is one more branch in this one, UK payment gateway UK. So in this one, we have a few more, like okay. So in this one, there is CC Avenue as well. So this is like, they'll be providing all these details to you. Okay. And we will be redirecting. This is a redirect URL and cancel URL. So these will be changing based on your, based on your payment gate. So that is why there is one more example. I have told you, right, second case. So in that second case, you can use this this particular branch, okay. So payment gateway UK will be there. So if your NIC is responding with post gateway, then you can refer to this particular like branch, and you can see, okay. So if you have any doubts, we can take.
This properties file, which you are adding, showcasing now, and like in the deployment case, obviously we'll be modifying in the YAML, and through that it will be getting updated, or we have to manually do this in this service properties file.
Okay. So so I think this has to be covered, right, already. So how this like yesterday's, 1 second, I think it should be in more services, infraops. Okay, and this infraops, Helm and chats, okay, sorry, no, sorry. Environment. If you go to this, 1 second, yeah, WML, okay. Control F, PG, okay. So this is where like they are giving, okay, 1 second. I think they have to, I'll show one more. Bihar, I can show you. So in Bihar, we are using, okay. So in Bihar, we will be using CC Avenue, so it is true. And access, we are like deactivating it. And this access code is there, right? So we are giving, if it is for production, this will be a different one. So even in the same, this URL is also, this is a redirection URL. So this is like test, that is like if it is production, then it will be secure, okay? So these will be overridden. Like for every file, like this will be like for every environment, there will be this file, YAML file. So in this, you can override all those properties in this YAML file, okay, for every service. Let it be MDMS, let it be persister, PDF service. Every service can be, every service, every parameter can be overridden. Okay.
Right.
Yeah. You have any other doubts, or we can?
And in case of multiple payment gateway, for example, if we are having the access also, and we are having the venue also in CC. So in that case, again, multiple is right now provided. Yeah.
Theoretically we can do it with the infrastructure we have. Okay, so theoretically we can do multiple payment gateways. Okay. So let's say if some some ULBs are using Access and some ULB want to use CC Avenue, then also we can use that. Whenever UI sending a request to form the redirection URL, at that time, if you are sending the payment gateway name as Access, then it will form the Access gateway redirection URL and it will send UI, and the flow will be same. And if you are sending it as a CC Avenue, then it will form the CC Avenue's URL and it will send you. So till now we did not tried it, but it supports it. So in the I think next month we have one requirement saying we want to use two payment gateways in one particular state. So that we will be going to do in next month.
Okay.
So based on the payment gateway name only, it will form the redirection URL. So I think there is no difficulty in that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So can we go to SMS or can we take a break? Or
we can take 5 minute break.
I want to get some water and I'll be back in a minute.
5 minute break.
We can take. Okay.
Yeah.
Sure.
So we'll be online.
Next, we're starting with the SMS.
Yeah. Okay. Right? Yeah. Yeah. Next one will be SMS.
Cool. Okay, we'll take a 10 minutes break.
We'll come back again.
We'll come back at 3:10.
Okay.
Omkar?
Yeah.
So, Omkar, after today, do we have any other session on Monday, Tuesday or Wednesday?
Yeah. We will send out that invites, Vipin. We have that sessions. So, it's planned.
So,
the invites are not up, so we'll send out those invites.
So, in that case, shall I send you my personal mail ID? Because with the Bell mail ID, I'm not able to configure that.
Yeah, so one request, Vipin. So the list is there with Shashikala ji. So if you will send me all the email IDs invited to be part of the demat, I'll add all of them beforehand.
Okay. Let him do.
Hi, can we start SMS? So SMS service is straightforward. So so it is SMS service will be taking the request through the Kafka. So this the Kafka is the only way to reach the SMS. So it won't. It is not having any internet access as well. Like this pod is not having. So so it will be listening to this. Topic name. So ego core notification dot service SMS. So you can configure this topic name as well. Like whenever, like in the I have shown you right in that particular YAML file, which is specific to the environment. So you can change that. Okay. So. Yeah. Okay. So whenever you sent any, 1 second, I'll open it. So SMS service is having only one listener service will be there, consumer. So SMS service. So these so whenever you push any message to the Kafka broker, which is like listened by this one, so which is like ego notification dot SMS. So it will read the request. And convert it into SMS request, and it will call the send SMS method in the service. So now here, so this SMS service has like this is an interface. So this has only one method. So this can be like implemented. So here we have a couple of them. One is like this is whenever we want to. Use like in development phase, like we don't want to send any SMS and we don't want to waste them, so that's why we use the console SMS. So it just logs the SMS and leaves it. So this one is the external external SMS. So you can implement couple more SMS services. And 1 second, I think it is not up to date. Okay. So anyway, I'm not sure. Like, there is one particular branch, is there? Okay, so I think I'm checking the wrong. I think I'm checking the wrong repository. So core services. This is. So we implemented country SMS, like, so this is another third party services. So we have like one service which is used by all the states. So one is like, one second. So this implementation has like of different implementations of each, like each vendor. So SMS is like most of the states will be using this one, MSDGSM. So I think you can also have the same access for this particular thing. So each state can register in this website and get the details from this. Okay, so I think. This there is like it is pretty much straightforward. Send SMS is like the only method you have to implement. So in this send SMS you'll be receiving these details. So what is the mobile number and what is the message you have to send to that number and what is the priority? So priority is like some vendors has like this priority as well. So this priority is. Whether you want to send it immediately or if it is sent later also is fine. Like, so it is not very urgent. So OTP is a like immediate urgency SMS. So whenever you want to send OTPs, then only you can use the priority as high. For the rest of the things, you can use the other priorities. Okay. So only these three are the parameters which is required for this particular SMS. So we'll take one example, MSDGM, GMS. So this is a central government provided scheme. So there will be, so one second, I think I can show this application. So yeah, this one. So this one has like this. these parameters. So to which URL you have to send the REST call. Okay, and this is like username, what is the username value you have to send it in that REST call. Could everyone go on mute? There's some disturbance here. Yeah, so like this is for the parameter name which you have to send as like saying it is as a username. Okay, and this is the parameter key and this is the parameter value for username. So this is similar way we have for password as well. And this is the sender ID which is provided by SMS gateway. So it is unique for each service. Okay, and this sender ID, okay, anyway, this is a service type is like what kind of like encoding you want to send it in the like for the sending SMS. Okay, and this is the content key, like sending the message. So, and this is the parameter name for mobile number. Okay, and this is the security key, which is also provided by the third party SMS vendor. So these two are provided by third party vendor, sender ID and secure key. Okay, and the secure key parameter is parameter, like key for the parameter, secure key parameter, sorry. Okay, so these are the details which we sent while we are sending the request to the third party SMS. Okay, so this can be different for each vendor. So for I think SMS country, okay, this SMS country gateway has like whole lot of other required things. So the common ones will be the username, password and URL and mobile number and message. And this also got like if you are sending SMS in Hindi or English, then also we have to mention the language coding type. So if you want to send like all different types of languages, then you have to mark it as Unicode message. Okay, then it will go in all languages.
This mobile number is the person who receives this message will see that as being received from this number, right?
No, that will be okay. So whenever you are configuring the registering with the vendor, at that time you can give this ID. So that will be the sender ID. So sender ID which they have given to us. So okay, based on that, they'll send the whoever received the SMS, they can see the sender name. So in our case, it will be like ULB SMS.
Okay.
So while registering, they'll be using that.
Okay. Then what is this mobile number actually? Whose mobile number is this?
This one.
Yeah.
No, this is just parameter key. So if you are you have to send a mobile number to the as a part of your request, right? So to find the mobile number, this will search with this key, mobile number key. Okay, let me show you an example. So the request will be like this. So https some mbgs.com/sms/?? And mobile number equal to some mobile number equal to, so it will use this key to send the mobile number. Okay, you understood, right?
This mobile number is a user's mobile number to which we have to send the message.
No, it is a parameter key.
Okay.
So each service has like, I think this
okay,
is
okay. Understood.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. Okay. If I show you the code, it will be a little bit. Implementation languages. So here we are forming the SMS URL. Hold on a second. Yeah. And the password. Yeah, I think we are not getting this. Yeah. Where is it? Not message. What is that common? Message. Okay. Yeah. I think we can. Okay, I think they have updated the code now. So, but like while sending the request, this is what we have to send. Okay. Yeah, anyway, so I'll show the other things. So only these are the required parameters which you have to change. Like, so if you got some other new vendor, that you have to use, okay, then you have to implement this SMS service, okay, send SMS, only one method you have to implement. So you can add one here, let's say this one is a new one, SMS country, SMS service. So you can use one more vendor, third party vendor name, and you can implement it, implement the send SMS method, that's it. So that SMS, send SMS method is like, what you have to do in that method is like, defined by the third party vendors. Okay. So regarding the SMS service, you just need to update this particular so this Kafka topic name, to which you can update the topic name if you want. Okay. And what else to change here? Maybe this config map will be changed. Okay. So for this, I think they updated. They are not using these details now. Okay. They are using this one. Username, password, sender ID, and security, secure key, which you have to send, mobile number. So these are the additional parameters which you have to send along with the URL. So these are the details, like request object can be formed from this one. Okay. I think there is nothing much in this SMS service to explain. I think it is.
This MSDG is a service provider, right?
Yeah, it is a SMS service provider, yes. So it is like this service is like works with the post call, REST call. So there are like some other different ways to access it, but we are using REST call now. So we just, whenever we get a request from, like whenever someone pushes into this particular topic, so what we do is like, it will listen using the consumer. Okay, it'll listen this through this consumer and process method will listen it and calls the send SMS. Okay, so this is where your method will directly call, like get called. And I don't think so there is any other like external changes or things which we have to know implementing this SMS. I think it is pretty straightforward.
Okay, REST call will send one message to one user, right?
Yeah, that depends on the third party URL, but here we are accepting only one request, like it is not a array list.
Okay.
Shiva.
Yeah.
Actually, in the case of bulk message, and in case of, like, normally you are following the structure, like, as I remember in OBPS, whenever you are having the customer implementation, you are putting in the same folder with the implementation or adding something default. In case of SMS, you are how this system will come to know if I define my custom SMS implementation.
You okay. which message template you are sending? Is it that one?
Here you are using this MSDGM. Okay. So if I add my own Java file, so how your API will understand that you the system need to call my custom implementation.
Okay, okay. So I think there should be a flag. One second. I think there should be one flag which says SMS is enabled. Okay, so yeah, based on this I think one second, I'll they recently updated this code. I'm not sure, like there should be one particular.
Okay, like in case of Alex, my point is in case of payment gateway, we are having the access gateway, and tomorrow we will be having one more gateway in the gateway Java folder, and NIC gateway. Okay,
mm-hmm.
How the system will come to know that it has to pick the NIC gateway file?
So that is where I have told you, right? Like in the request, when you are sending the transaction request, in that request you are sending the gateway name. Okay. Yeah,
that is gateway name. I'm saying the Java class wise implementation.
Sorry, implementation wise, like everything, every implementation will get loaded. Okay, whenever you say this particular name in there, like I'll show you. So this is the request one. Okay. Okay. In this one, you have transaction, right? Gateway name. This one is a gateway, which will send the name to this. Okay, based on this name, what we do is, like in transaction service, there is one more gateway service. Okay, based on this, we'll be using that. We'll picking the particular. One second. Okay, so this will call gateway. Okay, gateway map, and this will return the gateway which needs to be used. So
okay.
This will take the. So this was a map, right? Here for which name, which API implementation service it needs to use. Okay. So this method, based on like using this method, like we will provide input to this one as if it is access, then it will return the access gateway implementation.
Okay. So when I'm doing this implementation of gateway interface. In above the class only, do I have to annotate with some parameter like, okay, its name is, this class name is NIC, something like that? I'm saying in the Java's perspective, not like how the API is getting.
Okay, yeah, so let me tell you. So whatever there here, right, like in this particular implementation, so
right.
First of all, it will form a map with all the implementations present in our particular service. Okay, so be it like, it will, first of all, it will call the get method name here. I have shown you, right, like method name is there, this gateway name is there, right? Control C,
okay.
Controller. So with this method, first of all, it calls this method,
okay.
Like in this, and it gets the name and it forms the implementation against this name. Okay, so you don't have to change anything, just have to implement it as a component so that it will get picked.
Okay.
As a component, it will be in the Spring Bean.
So again, in this, the folder structure is gateway, implementation wise, gateway, then access, then that particular implementation, right?
You don't have to name it as a separate, but it will be easy for you to like check. You don't have to keep it in the access gateway, like access in the access, but it makes sense, right? So you have utility and access gateway.
Okay. Okay.
You don't exactly keep it in this in this order.
The component that it will detect, but I'm saying as a processor which you are following means as a standard.
Yeah, you can create a particular folder name and you can add it and implement there.
Okay. In case of SMS, are we following something like this or again there? I'm directly seeing the implementation file.
Okay. So you don't have to change the other implementations. You can create a new one. And so here, if you see, okay, service and impl is there. So in the inside the impl, you have different things. So this is for one particular implementation and this is for the second implementation. So you don't have to create a separate folder structure for it. And one thing I'm not sure is like how they are getting this particular implementation, like which implementation to take. That there will be some application key for that to which it has to use. I'm not sure like it is. There should be enable or disable, I think so.
Okay.
That I'll get back to you on this one. I'll check this one and I'll get back to you. How it will select the particular. I think we have to turn it off. And so this SMS enable is there, right? So this one, if it is true, then it will send it. So this one is recently updated. So previously what we have is only one, MSDG and console SMS. Okay, if SMS is enabled true, then it will use the MSDG, and if it is false, then it will use the console. But this SMS is recently added SMS country, so I have to check it and I'll get back to you on this one.
No, I think there is one. If you scroll down, there is one attribute, right? Okay. SMS dot go up.
Like, yeah, config.
No, go up. SMS.gateway.to-use SMS country. Is it that one?
Yeah, this one only we have to use. Yeah. So, but anyway, we have to the name right there. Okay. In this one, we have to be given the name here, which is the SMS name. Okay. Yeah. So this is the conditional property, right? So whenever based on this use is like MSDG, then it'll spin off this particular implementation, and it'll so in the same way, if it is SMS country here, then it'll do this one. Okay, yeah. Okay. So based on this particular thing, SMS user, like this is conditional means. So if this is not this value, then this particular service won't be in Spring Bean. Okay. So it will, at any given point of time, there will be only one particular implementation for SMS service. So that way it will take only one.
Okay. What about the OTP service? Means it's only providing the notification, right? So when the user first time registered it, you provide the OTP service, right? So that is also part of this, or that is different?
No, that is also part of this one only. So there is only one SMS service, and every service like forms their message. Like message will be formed in that particular service, and they'll just push the phone number and what message it needs to send to the Kafka.
And
it is a messing process, so they won't be tracking the whether the SMS is success or not. And even we have no method to check the SMSs.
Okay.
Yeah, whether if it is failed or success. Okay. So if in case of OTP, if it is not sent, then they'll try again. So there is no use. Like we have to check whether it is success or failure.
Okay. And we don't have the bulk message service, right, as such?
Yeah, a bulk message is not there. Previously, it used to be there, but this one they have updated, and I haven't checked this one. So if there is anything, I can send you. But because we are using Kafka, so we can push at a time like a number of service like. We are using us like we built another external service for us for our purpose like to send like we migrated the property to like all the properties now, so we want to send a message to. like citizen saying please pay the property tax. So for that we wrote a separate custom service, and it'll read the database and it'll push all the SMSs into this service. So it'll send slowly one after the other. Like we, so that is the reason we don't use the bulk SMS now.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, because pushing into Kafka doesn't take much time. So
yeah, pushing into Kafka on our side, it won't be a problem. But the receiver, the mobile subscriber side, who is providing the service, will be hitting their service for every single individual message.
Yes, that I think.
Okay.
Hmm. I'm not sure whether they most of the services will provide the bulk SMS, I guess. But we are not using it now.
Okay.
Yeah. Previously, I remember like initially when we started with SMS, there used to be some bulk SMS forms. So this like I have shown you the model, right? So this was like a list of SMS. This request will be a list of SMSs is there. So that is how it we worked previously. But for some reason, they have updated, like they removed this bulk SMS thing.
Okay.
Yeah. If you have any other doubts, I think I'll take.
Do you have some time? Because if you can explain the any flow from front end to back end, how the things are happening in your service wise or payment, like, because we are getting the information, but not as a complete flow wise.
Okay.
So as a developer, we want to see how the things are flowing from the React page to finally the database or Kafka or Elastic, whatever.
Okay, so okay, I'll try to explain that. So first of all, UI and backend like won't be in sync. First, I can say that one. Like in the sync, in the sense, there won't be any session main, like session means we have a token. Based on token, we'll be communicating. Okay, so UI is like it acts separately, independently to the backend, and even backend is not working as a like a commuted, like you can't say a backend as a single entity. Okay, it is like separate entity, but UI is a single entity. Okay, so whenever UI loads anything, like it is like a application, total single application. So it, first of all, it will call individual calls. Okay, it will make individual calls. So for that purpose, I can use my code. Okay, so if you see this one, so there will be multiple calls here. Okay, I'm in network tab and etc. So okay, if you see this one, this is like the tag there. So whenever this localization is a service which will like give the messages. So now we called it with the locale as like English. That is the reason it is sending, it is giving us the messages with English. Okay, for the if there is any label with this name, so it will replace it with the donation payments. Okay, sorry, deduction payments. So that is how it works, like localization. So and it will call again MDMS service to fetch the this call is to fetch, if you see here, so it is calling this MDMS criteria to fetch the tenants and citizen module. So this response will be having all the details about tenants. So let's say if the like it is having like 7 or 8 with 0, so 8 different tenants will be there. So whatever you say, if you say in like 1 second, inspect. Okay, if you say continue, then if it requires some more details, then it will make a calls to the database as and when it requires. Otherwise, if it doesn't require any data, then it won't call to the backend at all. Okay, So when you click on the Punjab, okay, so these details are like I've showed you now, right? It made a call to MDMS data and fetched those eight different cities. So those cities are coming from here, like from that call we are showing it here, okay, these seven cities, okay. And if you click on like continue, so it'll call a backend service, okay. So this service is like, if you see here, so that is a user service, because after the slash user is there, so this is where it this is the only like path you can define, you can say this service name, like okay. This is the path where you can find which service it is calling, okay, the first one. So it is calling this endpoint to get the token. I think this is EMP1 and EMP1 login is not correct. Okay. So if you see, there are like n number of calls going here, like when you are loading all the different things. So here, if you can see, so to load this part, they have one call. To load this part, like I think to show all these things, they'll be calling only one service, MDMS, okay, access service, okay. To show this work list, they'll be calling the workflow service.
Okay.
And to show all these different things, they'll be calling user service to show which are the different like tenants this employee registered. And if you change it to Hindi, then there will be one more call to the localization. So if you change it to Hindi, so this localization call is there. Localization to get the Hindi text for everything. Okay. So the message will be in Hindi. Similar way for every call, there will be a different thing. So I think these values are not there in the database, so as this is a dev. So you can add those values in the localization. You can push them and you can see those values here. Okay. I'll go with one example here. So I think there's no trade license. Okay, I'll go with this one. Omkar?
Yes, sir.
So can we show UK UK UAT? Like, can we demo it or?
Yeah, UAT is fine. UAT is fine.
UK UAT.
Yeah.
Okay.
So just wanted to check. I'm sorry, I was on another call. So what are you guys discussing?
They need one full flow from front end to back end, like how the data flows.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. 10 more minutes, I think I can conclude.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
So this will also be covered, right? In
this will be covered.
Yeah, I think.
I haven't seen the plan, so I think it might be covered or.
Yeah, anyways, okay. I mean, if we can wrap it up quickly, no problem. It'll cover once again.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
This is there, Vipin. So I've shared that plan with you, know. So this is there in 2-3 sessions. It's there in service documentation. It's there in front end, back end customization.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway,
no worries. Yeah. Go ahead, Siva.
Okay. Yeah. So I'll just try to explain this one in this one particular flow. Inspect. So I'm trying to create a new trade license. Okay. So whatever I do is like, I have these all details will be, these dropdowns will be like called to the MDMS data, master management data. Okay. So everything will be getting from there, these dropdowns. Okay. When I fill this one, after filling this one, okay. Even this Mohalla is like for each, based on the city selected, it will come. So since we are in Dehradun, it is automatically populated here. Okay, so when I click next, this is like one single form, but it is divided into two different screens. Okay, so if I give number, some number here. Okay, and click on next. Okay, so here is where like we will be creating the trade license. Okay, so whenever I click on the next, it will go to the this create call. Okay, so it will go to Uttarakhand TL service and create. So now we are hitting the backend service now. Okay, with the data. So this is the data we are sending. Okay, this will be like whatever data it requires. So this request info is like common for everything. So it will be covered in UI. So I'll only now talk about license. So license contains all the details which we have created now. We filled, right? All the details it will send into the backend service. Okay, from now it will shift to the backend service. Like the data, all data will be hitting the service. Okay, so in this backend service, like we wrote the individual endpoints, right? So core services. If we go to okay municipal services, we have to go. Okay, in this municipal service, so TL service is there, right? So it will directly come here and it will hit this one. Web service and controllers. So it will hit this endpoint directly. So V1 and create. Okay. So it will hit this one with the given data. From here, I think you are aware, right? So what we do is like we do the some business validations, okay? And it like when it comes to the saving part, like so it needs to save the data, right, to the database. So what it does is it pushes into the Kafka queue. So this Kafka queue is like in between. So we will do the reads from the service directly hitting the database, but the writes will be going through the Kafka. Okay, so this it will push all the required data as a JSON in JSON message into the Kafka queue. Okay, particular topic. Okay, so now this particular topic will be listened by the persister. So that persister, so based on the which topic it comes, so it will form the data and it will save into the database. So we are giving queries and everything to, as a config to this particular persister. Okay, and if there is so in the same way, whenever we are saving it to the persister, so the same way we are pushing it to the Elasticsearch topic as well at the same time. Okay, so it gets saved into the Elastic. So this Elasticsearch topic will be listened by indexer. This is another service which reads the data and pushes it to the Elasticsearch. Okay.
In the Elasticsearch, it will be saved as a JSON format, right?
Yeah, it will be saved as a JSON
format. What about the persister? In the Postgres also, will there be one column and the column holds the entire JSON data, no, or will it be split across columns?
No, it will be split across the columns, and that query will be giving as a config to the persister. I think this persister will be in your list. They'll explain
great.
It.
Okay.
Yeah. So that they'll be separate, it's set up separate topic and they'll be explaining it to you. And okay. So this, based on this architecture, like they'll be saving different things. So if it requires to trigger any SMS, say saying that your application has been created, so then it will push SMS with the format, with the number and the format to the SMS service listening topic. So it will be listened by SMS service and it will push into the like it will send the SMS. So you understood, right? What is like how it is on the high level.
Right. Yeah, okay. Actually, different. Okay.
If you have any doubts, or otherwise, we can close the session.
I have one question, but yeah, I think it will get covered in processor part. I just wanted to know that because it's an async call and ID will be generated, and means ID generation will happen and it has to respond back to the UI. So it will get
covered. ID gen is like a different service. ID gen is a different service. Okay.
But it will go through Kafka only, right?
No. IDgen is not through Kafka. So there is one more service called IDgen. I have shown you that format, right, while creating transaction. So what they do is like they do a REST call to that IDgen service and get the ID for that particular this particular license. Okay. And they'll add this ID and push into the like persister. So
yeah, okay. Sorry.
So I told you, right, reads are not async, only writes are async. So ID generation is a read, like it will hit only the sequence table, okay, and it will take the next number and it will add it there. So based on the, like, you can give a number of things, like which ULB you are sending and today's date, today's financial year, or like running sequence number, and all these things can be appended. Based on your given format, it will generate the ID. Okay, and you are sending this ID to the persister.
Okay. That will be, for example, wherever this, for example, I'm submitting a form, I should acknowledge a user. But till that time, Kafka is doing its process. Okay, for example, this new building application is coming up. And at that time only, we acknowledge that this is your application number.
Yeah, okay.
On the front end, right? So, yeah. It's because it's async. So at the same time, he won't get the response of the response as a unique number, application number.
No, that is where the ID gen will comes. Like it will generate the unique ID and sends. We will call the first ID gen service to get the unique ID. Okay. So after getting the unique ID, we'll push it to the Kafka, and return this particular unique ID to user.
So I mean, when I started this filling the form, at that time only I will be having one unique ID, along with that my data will flow.
No. Whenever you call the user, like create call is there, right? In that create call, we'll generate the new application number, and we'll push it to the Kafka and return to the user. After pushing to the Kafka is successful, then only we'll return the unique identification number to user.
Okay, so in the service, when you are showing it right now, so in that, first it created the ID, then it pushes to Kafka, and then it gives the response. So that unique ID generation was the sync call.
No, it is not a sync call. It is after receiving ID only, we'll proceed to the Kafka. After receiving response from ID gen with the unique ID, then only we'll proceed to the Kafka. If it is failing to generate the ID, then we will send a bad request to the user saying that I'll generate the ID.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So you, and this data will be persisted in Kafka for 6 or 7 days. So if the persister is failing for some reason, and we can, so this data will be there. And once you restarted, it will again starting. Like it, whenever it started again, it will pull all the pending messages and it will save the data again.
Okay. Thank you, Shiva. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Shiva. Shiva, just one request. Before disconnecting, will you please stop that recording so it will get saved in?
Yeah, I'm not sure it will save.
It will get saved to Elzen's drive, sir. So she'll send me the URL. I'll share that with Belting.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.